إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله إقرارا به وتوحيدا، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وصفيه من بين خلقه وخليله، أرسله الله بالهدى والدين الحق فأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وتركنا على المهجة البيضاء ليلها كنهارها لا يضل ولا يزيغ عنها إلا هالك. أما بعد، معاشر المؤمنين، أوصيكم وأوصي نفسي بتقوى الله، فإن من اتقى الله وقاه وجعل له من كل ضيق وهم فرجا ومخرجا. ثم أما بعد، لو استطعنا أن نلتقط صورة من حياة رسولنا صلى الله عليه وسلم التي نعدها من أجمل وأورع الصور في حياته، لعل أن تكون كما رواه أصحاب السير والمغازي من ابن هشام وابن إسحاق وابن كثير وغيرهم في أواخر حياته صلى الله عليه وسلم، لما مرض في آخر حياته وقد أمر أبا بكر رضي الله عنه أن يصلي بالمسلمين، ففي أواخر الأيام قبل أن يقبض الله روحه الشريفة رأى المسلمين مصلين خلف أبي بكر رضي الله عنه مجتمعين في صف واحد مؤتلفين، فابتسم ابتسامة عجيبة صلى الله عليه وسلم تقريرا بتلك الحالة وإعجابا منها. لماذا؟ لأنه قد تمت رسالته صلى الله عليه وسلم. فجاء والناس في الجاهلية قبائل وفرق متعددين شتى متفرقين منازعين، فجاء صلى الله عليه وسلم برسالة الإسلام وجمعهم تحت عقيدة واحدة وتحت دين واحد فأصبحوا إخوانا. فلذلك امتن الله سبحانه وتعالى عليهم وذكرهم بتلك النعمة، فقال سبحانه وتعالى: واذكروا نعمة الله عليكم إذ كنتم أعداء فألف بين قلوبكم فأصبحتم بنعمته إخوانا وكنتم على شفا حفرة من النار فأنقذكم منها. وهكذا الإسلام جاء وألف قلوب المسلمين، فقال الله سبحانه وتعالى: وألف بين قلوبهم. لو أنفقت ما في الأرض جميعا، يذكر رسوله، لو أنفقت ما في الأرض جميعا من الأموال من ذهب وفضة ما ألفت بين قلوبهم ولكن الله ألف بينهم. وهكذا الإسلام معاشر المؤمنين جاء وعزز الأخوة في الدين فأصبحنا إخوانا. فالصحابة رضي الله عنهم فهموا هذه الرسالة وآمنوا برسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فأصبحوا إخوة في الدين. أقوى الروابط في هذه الحياة الدنيا الأخوة في الإسلام، أقوى من الأخوة في الدم والنسب بنص القرآن والسنة. لكن الله المستعان، فخلفنا ذلك الجيل وننظر إلى مجتمعنا وإلى حالنا وإلى أسرنا وقبائلنا ونرى الافتراق والمنازعات والضغائن والشحناء في قلوبنا. والله المستعان وإليه الشكوى. الإسلام جاء وعزز الأخوة في الدين، فقال صلى الله عليه وسلم: المسلم أخو المسلم لا يظلمه ولا يسلمه. وقال صلى الله عليه وسلم: لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يحب لأخيه ما يحب لنفسه. وهذا التغليب يشمل الذكور والإناث، فالأخوة للإخوة وأيضا لأخواتنا المسلمات. فهذا هو ميزاننا معاشر المؤمنين. إذا أردنا أن نحقق الإيمان كما وصفه لنا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، فلا بد أن نحب لإخواننا ما نحبه لأنفسنا. ففي أي تصرف مع أخيك أو مع أختك في الإسلام، لا بد أن تنظر: هل أنا في هذا التصرف وفي هذه النية وفي هذه المعاملة وفي هذه الكلمة، هل أنا محب لهذا الأخت؟ هل أنا محب لهذا الأخ أو لهذه الأخت ما أنا أحبه لنفسي؟ لأن هذا هو الميزان عندنا معاشر المؤمنين. Dear brothers and sisters in Islam, if we were to capture one of the most beautiful pictures and images from the life of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then surely it would be towards the very end of his life, when he became sick sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And so therefore he commanded Abu Bakr to lead the prayers. So in the last few days before Allah took away his soul, he looked at the Muslims praying behind Abu Bakr radiallahu an, and he saw that they were united and that they were in one line, one row, praying behind one Imam, Abu Bakr. So therefore he smiled at this, being pleased in this condition for the companions. Why? Because it was the pinnacle of his message sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He came and he found a people who were disunited, disgruntled, having all kinds of strife and conflict and problems within themselves, each tribe getting ready to eat the other tribe. When one of them would kill another person, then they would gather and seek revenge. Unlike that, a cycle. So he came and he united their ranks upon Islam, and he unified them until they became one brotherhood. So therefore, when he looked at them and they were praying like that, he approved of it. So therefore he smiled at that condition. And we know from the aqsam, from the types of his sunnah, is the sunnah at-taqririyya, the sunnah of the thing that he approved of. So therefore he approved of them praying behind Abu Bakr in one brotherhood and in one sisterhood of Islam. This is what Islam came to do. It came to unite people, and it came to remind them of the bigger picture, that you, despite whatever you may have in your heart against your fellow brother or sister in Islam, the bigger picture is that you are placed in this one life as a test. As Allah says, وَجَعَلْنَا بَعْضَكُمْ لِبَعْضٍ فِتْنَةً أَتَصْبِرُونَ, that indeed we have made each of you a fitna, a trial and a tribulation, in order for us to see if you shall be patient upon this test. So this is it. Allah will test you in your family, with your sons and your daughters, with your neighbors, with your brothers and your sisters, and with your fellow family members, in order for him to see what kind of human being are you, and are you the person who will implement his rulings, and will you be able to elevate yourself above your personal gains and your fleeting emotions, and actually look at the brotherhood and the sisterhood that Islam came to establish, not only amongst the Muslims themselves, but even for the whole of humanity, inviting them to this religion of monotheism. For this reason, Islam came with guidelines to preserve and to save this brotherhood and this sisterhood. For example, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he gave us this scale of how to judge the level to which we are truthful and sincere when we say that we are brothers in Islam. We all said, "You're my brother. I love you for the sake of Allah, oh ya akhi." But are we really brothers? Are we really implementing the saying of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he said, "La yu'minu ahadukum hatta yuhibba li akhihi ma yuhibbu li nafsi"? That none of you truly believes iman al haqiqiyan, a true iman, an iman which comprises of speech and action. It increases with the obedience of Allah and it decreases with his disobedience. He said, none of you will completely fill this iman. And of course, iman is of yataba'ab, it's of types. And it is of levels. So even though you may not have one level of iman, it does not remove you from it. A difference between some of the sects of Islam, who when an individual commits an error or a mistake, they remove them from the fold of Islam and iman. We say, no, Islam is of types. The highest, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, is to testify truthfully that there's none deserving of worship in truth except Allah. And the lowest of it is to remove something harmful from the floor and from the way of the people. And that indeed shyness and bashfulness is a part of iman. But he said, you will not complete this iman until when you love for your brother what you love for yourself. Subhanallah. How hard is this? So therefore I remind myself first and I remind you, dear brother and dear sister in Islam, when you speak to your fellow brother or your fellow sister in Islam, when you dish them out, whatever treatment you're going to dish out to them, when you deal with them, are you putting in front of you this hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Or are we putting instead our desires and our emotions? And is the shaitan coming and playing with us? For indeed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Inna shaitan ya'is an ya'budahu al-musalluna fi jaziratil arab walakin fi at-tahrish fi ma baynahum," or kama qala sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that indeed the shaitan has given up hope that the people that established the salah in the Arabian Peninsula will ever worship him. But however, he has not given hope in that he will cause and continue to cause strife and division between their ranks. So this is the door that we need to close, dear brothers and dear sisters in Islam. And when we look at ourselves, we look at our families, our communities, we find that we are in greater need of this guideline than ever before. We don't have to look far beyond this masjid. We hear reports of brothers not giving salam to other brothers. We hear reports of people making hijrah from other people, i.e. not giving them the salam, not giving them the right. Some of the sisters are falling into this error. For indeed, this is against Islam, I remind you. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "La tabaghadu wa la tahasadu ولا تناجشوا وكونوا إخوان الله وكونوا إخوة في الإسلام وكما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم." That indeed do not hate each other and do not turn your backs against each other and do not seek to make interactions to cheat one another. Indeed, be brothers. ولا يحل لمسلم أن يحجر أخاه فوق ثلاث كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم. And that it is not permissible for a Muslim to not give salam and to turn his back or her back from her fellow Muslim sister or from his fellow Muslim brother above 3 days. Why? To safeguard the integrity and to safeguard the nature of this brotherhood which Islam so holds in high esteem and holds in such high regard. Because at the end of the day, that's what we are. We are ikhwa. When Allah said, in the beginning of the khutbatul haq, when Allah said in the beginning of Surah An-Nisa, "Ya ayyuha an-nas, ittaqu rabbakum alladhi khalaqakum min nafsin wahida wa khalaqa minha zawjaha wa batha minhuma rijalan kathiran wa nisaa'a wattaqullaha alladhi tasaaluna bihi wal arham innallaha kana alaykum raqiba." He said, "Oh you mankind," and this is in Surah An-Nisa. It's a surah madaniyah. So therefore, the expectation is for Allah to address the believers, O ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, but rather he began the khitab with, O you people, to remind of the universality and the importance of the message that's going to come. Fear Allah, your Lord, who created you from one soul, Adam alayhi salam. Kullukum li Adam, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, all of you are from Adam. And then he said, from this one human, Allah created his mate, Hawa. And from the two of them, Allah created countless men and women. So therefore, fear Allah and fear the ties of the kinship. So this is it. We are brothers and we are sisters in humanity. So therefore, let us safeguard the sacredness of this ties of kinship. For indeed, the womb is even ascribed in terms of linguistics to the name of Ar-Rahman, because it's the Rahim. Allah showing us the sacredness of it and how it is not a joke. So how is it that we find in our families people fighting each other over wealth, over inheritance, brothers not giving their salams to their sisters and cutting them off? I remind myself first, and I remind you that this is not what Islam came to do, and that we have to rewind the narrative, and we have to check ourselves, because this is not healthy for us. When we find in a small community like this, we find divisions and we find rifts. But how could we ever get our message to this country, which according to statistics is only about 2.5% Muslim? If we believe in our religion, surely we must recognize that we have much good to give to society. But how can we be in a position to give this good if we are so divided amongst ourselves? We don't want to cooperate, that we don't want to help each other out. Rather, we're even happy to see the downfall of each other. A'udhu billah min dhalik. We seek Allah's refuge from that. What kind of message are we going to give to the people? They're going to say, I'm sorry, but sort yourself out. Fix your house first before you come to us. Subhanallah. In order for us to achieve this sense of brotherhood and sisterhood that Islam has tried so hard and given so many guidelines, we have to be true to our tradition. So amongst the guidelines that Islam has come to give us is, let us have good thoughts for each other. Ihsan al-dhan. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam warned us against having bad thoughts about each other. He said, "Iyyakum wa dhann, fa inna dhanna akdhabul hadith." He said, be aware of having negative thoughts about each other, because that's one of the ways in which the shaitan shoots his arrows, that you come and you have negative and evil thoughts about your brother or your sister. You start to doubt their intentions and their actions. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Leave that, for it is indeed the most false of speech." Rather, upon Islam, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam showed us that we only nahkum bil zawahir, that we only judge upon that which is apparent. So for that reason, if somebody comes to us and says, "We are Muslim, and I'm a Muslim," we take him upon that which is apparent and outward for him. We have not been commanded to open the hearts of the people to find what is inside them, because we do not know. But rather, if somebody says to us, "I did such and such because of such and such," we take his speech for that, or her speech for that. So therefore, let us have this element of having good thoughts about each other. One of the other guidelines that Islam came to teach us is the element of being humble. And indeed, nobody humbled themselves except that Allah elevated him. Our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself showing us this humility and this humbleness. That despite whatever rank and whatever status that you may have, however power you may have, or how much wealth you may have, brother or sister, humble yourself. You're a human being. As some of the scholars said, how can you afford to be proud and arrogant when in the beginning you were just a piece of water that was ejaculated, and in the end you will just be a corpse that will rot in the ground, and in between these two conditions you are just urine and feces. Akramakumullah. So how can you afford to elevate yourself and to be proud and haughty? This is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the one who Allah sent, the best of mankind. In the Sulh of Hudaybiyah, one of the defining moments of the history of Islam, when Quraysh were making a treaty with him, And in the treaty he said, he was going to stipulate that this is what Muhammad, Rasulullah, writes and is going to make a treaty with Quraysh. But they said to him, if we believe that you are the Prophet, then indeed we will not have fought you. So remove that from the treaty. He was not proud, he was not arrogant, but rather he humbled himself. He told the Sahaba Ali, who was writing the terms of the condition, if I'm right, he was hesitant in removing that. But however, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, remove it, teaching them humbleness and humility. And he said, remove that and write in it, in its place, Muhammad ibn Abdullah. Muhammad, the slave and the servant of Allah. For that reason, we find that when Allah praises His Prophet, He calls him the Abd. And this is the highest form of praise that Allah has given His Prophet. So therefore, when we look at ourselves, we find that we become amazed by our achievements in life, or by our wealth and our positions of authority. We start to find it difficult to back down and to compromise. We have someone who is greater than us, the one who Allah sent as His Prophet, showing us the willingness to back down for the sake of uniting and for the sake of making peace. So therefore, this is the challenge for us, dear brothers and dear sisters in Islam. I therefore challenge this community, beginning with myself first, let us make our priority in making peace and making reconciliation. Because this is what Allah commanded us when He said, وَإِنْ طَائِفَتَانِ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ اَقْتَتَلُوا فَأَصْلِهُ بَيْنَهُمَا. That indeed, if two groups from the mu'mins, from the believers, were to fight and disagree, then indeed make peace amongst them. So therefore, let us make this habit of making peace within ourselves. And Islam has given so many guidelines in making peace, amongst which we have mentioned having positive thoughts about each other, being humble, being able to put our differences aside and looking at the bigger picture, in that we are brothers and sisters in Islam. قَدْ قُلْتُ مَا سَمِعْتُمْ وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ وَلِسَائِرِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ فَاسْتَغْفِرُوهُمْ وَتُوبُوا إِلَيْهِ إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. الحمد لله على إحسانه وشكر له على توفيقه وامتنانه وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا الداعي إلى رضوانه. Dear brothers and dear sisters in Islam, indeed, we are all imperfect. And Islam came to acknowledge this. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, كلكم خطاء وخير الخطائين التوابون. That indeed all of you make mistakes, but the best of you that makes mistakes are those that go back and correct themselves and rectify themselves. So therefore, in this admonition of mine, okay, we have our faults within our communities, but the onus and the responsibility is upon us to start to rectify these faults. For indeed, Islam taught us to never ever lose the initiative and to always be on the forward foot and to take the initiative. So for that reason, even when the people have differences within themselves, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, when the two Muslims who are disagreeing within themselves, they come and one of them turns the back and the other one turns the back, he said, the best of them, look at this, how Islam always initiates and how Islam has always encouraged the Muslims to be on the forward and to be on the front foot. He said, the best of them is the one that begins with the salam. So therefore, let us get used to this habit of being the ones who extend our hands of reconciliation and of making peace within ourselves and within our households. This requires a great deal of responsibility. And this is what being a man and being a woman is. Not running away from our responsibilities. Facing up to the hard realities that we may be facing in our families. That yes, we may have difficulties. We may have problems in our marriages. We may have issues in our families. But let us not be amongst those that try to shift the responsibility and saying it's because of this person or that person, or it's because of black magic or sorcery. Take the responsibility, dear brother and dear sister in Islam. If you are the man of the house, or you are the woman of the house, get a grip of the affair. You start looking at the reasons for why there is that rift and why there is that conflict, and you start solving them one after the other. And indeed, let us never ever lose the initiative. And let us never ever give hope. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying, لَوْ قَامَتِ السَّاعَ وَبِيَدِ أَحَدِكُمْ فَصِيلَةً فَلْيَغْرِسْهَا. that indeed, even if it was as dire and as last minute and as desperate that the hour was to be established, and you had in your hand a seed, the Prophet ﷺ said, what do you do with it? He said, plant it. You do not think about what the fruit is going to be. You do not think about what are the consequences. But rather you see something good, go ahead and do it, dear brother and dear sister in Islam. Do not waste time. Do not say, I'm going to wait until this day or that day. You go ahead and you do it. Indeed, Allah has commanded us to send prayers and salutation upon the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَمَلَائِكَتَهُ يُصَلُّونَ عَلَى النَّبِيِّ يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا صَلُّوا عَلَيْهِ وَسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد وبارك اللهم على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد وارض اللهم عن الصحابة أجمعين أبي بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي وعنا معهم بمنك وكرمك يا أكرم الأكرمين اللهم عز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم عز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم عز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم ألف بين قلوبنا واجعلنا صفا واحدة برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين اللهم حبب إلينا الإيمان وزينه في قلوبنا وكره إلينا الكفر والفسوق والعصيان واجعلنا من الراشدين برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم آمنا في أوطاننا واصلح أئمتنا وولاة أمورنا اللهم اجعل ولايتنا في من خافك واتقاك واتبع سبيل رضاك برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين عباد الله أقيموا الصلاة